I'm on the get rid of those late game champions train right now, because Ekko, it was a problem, but Oduwame was containing him, and Gamsu, he hasn't been the main cause of the games going awry, he's just been a part of it. One of the main problems has been Azir late game.
But I do like taking it away from teamfight presence. Yeah. Gamsu has hit some really big parallel convergence stuns. One that even pretty much turned that game, allowed them to take out Jankos for results. So unfortunately, the Ren smite combo wasn't available, and you saw what happened.
Yeah, not taking away from Gamsu's performance, but in my opinion, it was like a win more pick. It was that sure. Everything else was being set up, and they secured the deal with the Ekko. Lucian will also be banned away, and hey, there's the Azir. So hit the nail on the head on that one.
So we are still looking perhaps at that first pick, Kindred, for H2K. I don't think that actually changes the dynamic of the first rotation here, because if Alistar and Braum are both available, one gets through, the other gets through. You know, if we see one banned, it could, however, be the first pick, but I still think we're on for that first pick, Kindred.
All right, so two things. This is the first time that H2K have had access to Twisted Fate all playoffs long. Secondly, even if Kindred is locked in, I think Fnatic won't mind, because Jankos has not had any early game impact on that champion, and the few team fights that we saw him take part in, the Lamb's Respite was not game-changing. You contrast it to how, for example, Amazing used it with Origin last weekend. There you've got a game-changing Kindred player. So 30 seconds on the clock, a lot of time available for H2K to decide what they prioritize, and we'll find out what it'll be.
Also, as the last ban being Ryze instead of Twisted Fate, that's now available for Ryu, so that's a potential mix-up here from H2K. And the big question is, do they carry on putting priority onto Jankos? Answer, yeah.
I like it still. As I said, I don't think much of the H2K's first rotation gets changed from this. You still want the jungle matchup. Yes, the Graves would have been available as well, but this has, you know, been a pick that H2K have focused on for their first pick, and it's been working fine. Both supports get through. You know, Sivir should be a priority, but in this series hasn't been at all. No team's been wanting to touch it. So we
the
may see
it. Card has not been activated yet.
Yet.
Yet. 2-1-3 records. I don't know. I just think I'm very critical of this performance, because we had quite a big discussion around Jankos and Kindred, and I was not a believer coming into the series because he only played it twice. My personal opinion is he's better on a champion that can set up ganks rather than a guy that has to get the kills in the ganks. And I don't know, I'm just not seeing the performances from what was one of Europe's best junglers in the regular split.
I think it's fair to say that he works better on those enabling junglers. Okay, that is a first rotation Ezreal. Huh. I cannot believe I'm saying that, but in this series it seems to make sense. We know that the Sivir is not working for H2K, and you've got a Braum to go alongside this Ezreal, so Sivir's effectiveness is lowered in teamfights. That kind of means, do we get to see the Kalista matchup again, that while it worked in the lane against Fnatic, was not an effective pick for H2K in the teamfights, which is where Kalista in the mid and late game should be excelling.
And now that puts pressure onto Forgiven's champion pool, but we know he has a big enough champion pool to do it. We've seen Corki, we've seen Caitlyn, but where does he go from here? Because I absolutely agree, he was getting caught out a lot. Also in individual picks, that pick in the mid lane by Fevvin as well, he just can't get out of it as Kalista. So we'll see if he goes for something else here.
I am really wondering, now that we've seen this Ezreal, what is it Fnatic are wanting from their jungle? Because Graves would be the obvious option here, which you could have taken then. Maybe they were scared of Forgiven taking away the Ezreal for Ezreal Alistar lane that we have seen a couple of times out of H2K, because the Alistar has been locked in.
So definitely a steal possibility. And on the side of H2K, very, very stern faces. The camera was cutting there between Prolly, Forgiven, Vanda, and very serious looks on their faces as we get into what could be H2K's last game of the spring split, and potentially their first time placing fourth. It will be a Gragas lock-in, so a pivot for Spirit, or rather for Gamsu in that top lane. Although, yeah, we could see Flex, but I'm expecting it.
It's much more likely to be the Graves jungle Gragas top lane, so gives you engage and disengage potential, another source of AP, wave clear, tankiness. It's kind of nice. It's good. We've grown accustomed to it from Sartorius and Challenger.
Indeed.
Before it exploded into the world, it's a fairly common pick all world round now.
And also because Gamsu's a tank player, so it's not difficult to make the guess on that one.
There are champions that I can play that tank and do damage?
No way!
Yeah, he just goes full tank Graves, like, am I doing it right? No. Looking at those last two pickups from H2K now.
So that's going to be mid lane as well as their ADC to round out the comp. Just to finalize that Gragas point, Gamsu played it once, lost with that already. So will be the second time. Corki comes out for Forgiven instead of Sivir. This was an interesting turn in this third place matchup and that Lissandra final.
And instead of Kalista here. So with their mid lane, they go, let's set up fights with their AD carry. He's like, I want to poke people down. I want to siege. And then the Lissandra can maybe go in, set us up for the fight. So if H2K botch these fights with Alistar, Lissandra, Maokai, and Kindred, there are massive problems in this game because these four champions are so effective at diving. It is unreal.
And somewhat the opposite of what yourself and the analyst desk were talking about. Not really that scaling, you know, let's go even along and just out-survive them. Last pick for Febavin. It will be a mid lane counter. He has run Kassadin once before. It is almost the quintessential Fnatic champion. Something that has been used by the organization in all of their years of League of Legends.
Is that the reason why they run it, Trevor?
Yes, yes, it is attached to the name.
It's the brand.
They're just wishing that it hadn't have been like Shushe on Gragas back in season one, so they could have like Fnatic Kassadin, but it has been locked. The Kassadin for Febivin. This is the thing that we thought was going to get punished in game one of the Vitality series when Fnatic just got pushed in super hard. Now you've got that side lane control. First game, we're going to see Fnatic with the double teleport here.
Now we'll definitely change up the dynamic, but that's exactly what you said at the very start of the day, that Febvin will always have those champions to counter out Ryu. There we have it, final pick in this game on match point.
Yeah, and I'm just a little nervous about the wave clear from Fnatic. It is okay, but it is not great, and I think if they get shoved in, it could be problems.
And that's the thing, is the pushing potential from, if you look at the likes of a Corki where he wants to siege, you've also got the Kindred. The Lissandra's pretty good as well when you look at the push potential and the dive potential that H2K want to set up. Problem is, locking down a Kassadin is always going to be difficult. If you can hit him pre-6, it's kind of okay, but if he ever gets 2 kills, good luck.
But you've got to take the teams into account here as well, because H2K are just historically, and from what we've seen today, just not good at team fighting. And now that they have this very good team fighting comp, you're right, if they fail here, then nothing will work. But you could also go for a different type of composition, but it's hard to in the current meta. Like, it's just a lose-lose situation. That's what it feels right now from H2K, and they can't think like that, but I know if I was in this situation, I would be.
And the problem gets compounded more because H2K lost a series where their aggressive team fights and aggressive tower dives cost them games against Origin. Not only do they have to get over all of those problems, they also have to deal with this 6,000 person crowd in Rotterdam that is so clearly behind Fnatic. Mm-hmm. It is a mental challenge in every single regard for what could be the last game of the day.
It's an uphill struggle. We're now on match point. H2K, they are one loss away from Fnatic securing this series.
And let's see if Forbidden goes off in his hometown on the quintessential Fnatic pick that Kassadin. Maybe we'll see some crazy stuff. But honestly, H2K, they've got to be looking at this game, saying to themselves, what's gone wrong in the last two games? How can we fix this? They've got themselves a little bit more of a simple setup for team fights, and that should, in theory, be easier to execute now, as Fnatic have gifted you. They've gone like, hey, we'll take an Ezreal, we'll take a Kassadin. Let's see.
Indeed we shall. Fnatic going for this 5-man invade for the Vision in the early game. Took a couple shots from Jankos. And then that will equally mean that Forgiven and Vandal will get two wards on the bottom side, so you've got the lane swap wards, and Fnatic will be backing out. No, they will not. They will be setting up a Fnatic death push over a ward.
Well,
are they just trying to do
observers?
It's like everything that Fnatic's famous for is like, we'll pick the Kassadin, we'll do a death push.
Everybody be quiet. Just don't give the game away. Fnatic right now, they're waiting.
Like, Bevan doesn't care, he's out. I'm opting out.
Clay's like, I'm done with this. I've only been on this for a little while. Why do you guys do this? Why do you make me do these silly rituals?
All right, we'll find out later, hopefully. But for now, it looks like lane swap is going to be initiated. The jungle has been divided in half with Spirit and Gamsu currently holding hands. And Reckless and Clay, they're going to be clearing out the Gromp before they make their steps out. Pretty exciting wave going on in the crowd at the minute as Vanda and Forgiven will find themselves uncontested in the bottom lane. So it is another lane swap game, of course.
Yes, indeed. Fnatic and Gamsu, of course, taking away this blue buff, and their strong side will be on the left-hand side of the map. And they'll be controlling the wave.
Hey, there is a lot about minion wave manipulation here in a lane swap pulse.
Crowd manipulation.
I'm kind of wondering, Sina, how Fnatic handle the second phase of the lane swap, because, you know, their first phase was good. They came out ahead. They, you know, did a decent job on the second wave, and
So is the crowd.
Yeah, they are. They've kept this going for quite a while.
There's
a lot of energy still in there.
Yeah,
usually it dies out in like
the
second round.
This is why I love being in the round. Certainly provides a different dynamic.
Yeah, because it kind of dies
actually
on
makes
one side.
It a lot easier to go around for the wave. But gentlemen, towers will be dropping shortly.
Hey!
Yes, sir. Hey!
Actually, yeah.
Are we on the other side?
I think we're the other side.
That's fine, doesn't matter. It was a 50-50.
We tried.
It was a 50-50. But let's take stock. H2K will be dropping the tower marginally ahead of Fnatic. So no real difference. Both top laners going to secure that additional local gold. And really, lane swaps are determined by the next steps, the next stages. Who looks at Herald and who looks at those next Alpha Towers?
Yeah, I mean, looking at this situation, it's going to be the same or a similar situation as last time. HK will prioritize the Herald because they now put their duo lane up to the top side. They're going to push that in. Then they can come down for the Herald, but it's mid lane. Ryu has been ganked in both games of this third place series. Oh, top lane!
It's actually Vander who's gonna go in for the kill. He gets the combo onto Gamsu. A nice flash over that very thick wall. It's actually hard to land that flash.
Ryu's getting chased down into the lower jungle here.
It's like, not again!
Oh, no real CC chances though. First blood is avoided. Dwarf Doom goes in, locks Clyde down in place. Yankus is coming to support. This is a 2-on-2, and Clyde doesn't have the damage to back.
Here's Vander.
There goes Wolf, looking for more damage. Defensive flash over the wall. Vander gets the hit, but pulverized onto Clyde. First blood secured by H2K.
It's like, why is there an Alistar in my name? But it's because that top lane trade happened, and he was already in the right area. So well played by H2K.
Very well played. As you look at how they grouped, they know Forgiven has the freedom top lane to push that in. They'll rejoin him later on in this lane swap phase of this play, but man, at this point Ryu, all of the pressure was on him, and he goes, yeah, I've got my team behind me, it's all good. Now, flashes.
Flash away from Fevazar, and a risk. Alistar was coming in from behind, trying to set something up. H2K change their picks and bans, they get a lane swap, and they are the ones playing on the aggressive foot.
That's the key thing here. They're playing extremely aggressively, but Fnatic were the ones who actually invaded into the jungle first.
And this is one of the things that I am actually quite liking Ryu's Lissandra for, and just in general Lissandra play, is you can set up the start of these fights very effectively, and from here, it's a done deal. For Fnatic fans, they may kind of, sigh there. A sight of Klai getting picked off is one that, at least once he joined the team, was something that people have become accustomed to seeing. Started to be tightened up a little bit, but maybe regression here in Game 3. They've gone back to an old set up with their picks and bans and an old start to the game for Fnatic as well.
But if you're a Fnatic fan, you can be like, well, it's just unlucky Alistar happened to be there, because he was really the reason they picked up that kill, because he was coming down from the top lane trade.
I haven't spoken to a lot of pros. Unlucky is the exact reasoning for that momentary play. Regardless, Fnatic will even out the tower trade, so there's still 1,000 gold down, thanks to the CS advantages for both mid and top on the side of HTK, and obviously the first blood gold, which will be helping them out. I want to take a look at how Fnatic decide to play. They're once again from behind. They're once again in a team comp that can get pushed in lane, and they got limited wave clear.
Yeah, very limited wave clear, especially early on here. Of course, Ezreal True Shot Barrage is going to be used fairly effectively off cooldown every time it's available. But in between those points, Reckless doesn't have the greatest ability to actually hold mid lane. He'll sit in mid as this game opens up. We'll see Febavan go to the bottom lane. We'll see Gamsu stay up the top and kind of alternate depending on who their lane opponent is. And Fnatic will just sit their mid lane with their duo and go, okay, try and push in. And in this game, I actually think H2K will just ward up the sides and dive.
That was good timing on the ward from Yankos. Had he gone into the bush, he probably would have been dead. Fnatic was setting that up. You can usually tell, like, when the Ezreal starts putting Essence Flux onto his team, it's like, he's gonna go for a fight.
Well, talking about going for a fight, Yankos is looking for one in the middle lane.
Here they go!
36 though, that's locked in place by the Tomb. Easy pickup for Yankos. That was the tower dive you were talking about.
Tower diving by the numbers. Just completely go in, take one person down. Spirit had no chance, no flash, nothing to save him. Easy kill.
So it's perfect play from H2K, and they're just speeding up their game, which is what the analyst desk was saying, what we were saying on the caster desk. You have to try and challenge Fnatic. I just didn't know if H2K had it in them. Apparently they do.
Yeah, at least for the first 7 minutes, 2,000 gold advantage for H2K. That's going to get extended even further once that mid tower goes down. Reckless is like, oopsie, didn't want that trade. Because Forgiven comes out in a better scenario, and there we go. Nearly 3,000 gold HTK have a lead.
And when you look at the timing on this, we're only just past 7.5 minutes. Normally a mid tower and a lane swap goes down on average around 19 minutes in the EU LCS here, at least in the regular split. So now we're seeing this HTK aggression earlier on in this game. They've cracked that all important mid tower. You can get the vision control down now, constantly look to move between lanes and set up the lanes that you want here. You only have one teleport available, but that's one more than Fnatic have right now.
Hey, and maybe Yankos had a cup of coffee between these games, because he's 2-0. He is a guy who is famous for his early game impact. He picked up First Blood, and he's continuing to apply pressure and find weaknesses in the Fnatic game in this match 3.
I find it funny you talk about Yankos and he just like pulls his sleeves up. It was business time for Yankos.
Well, return of the First Blood King. He is finally back. And 2-0-0 in this game. Large impact, again going for that Devourer.
Is it like Proly lifts him up on like a rock formation? All of the H2K fans.
He is not Simba.
That wasn't the film reference I was going for, but I'll take it.
Regardless of that fact, Fnatic now have to play from a very big deficit, and the double teleports from H2K can be used to extend this lead if they don't botch the plays. I've had a very good start thus far. We're approaching 10 minutes. HTK snapping some control in this bottom lane. Look, again, Forgiven farming while the rest of his team clear out the jungle nearest to him. And Odo's left alone to deal with Gamsu up top.
Yeah, at this point, you know, speaking about HTK and their team fighting, I mean, from this series alone, you'd have enough to fill an episode of Botchamania at this point. But HTK are looking to push down on the bottom tower here. This is the kind of thing they need to do, however. Look at Fnatic grouping behind the tower. Two-shot barrage comes out, but HTK have this.
Yeah, it's actually not enough to clear the back line of minions, which is really unfortunate because that allows them just to take down the tower. 9 minutes into the game, almost a 4,000 gold advantage for H2K. If they can convert this into an early win and continue to keep pushing in, we could actually open up the series.
Yeah, that's what H2K are going to be hoping for. But they are still very, very far from that Fnatic Nexus. It is 4 towers to 2, and H2K have inner turret available, both the top and middle lane. Some good vision to allow HTK to secure a very safe dragon.
We're starting to hit item breakpoints as well. Ryu, Abyssal Scepter in the mid lane, opting to, away from the Rod of Ages. Bot lane, of course, Triforce is going to be the item of choice for Forgiven. Top lane, Oda Wami going towards Spectre's Cowl against Gamsu. But we haven't really spoken about the top lane because they're two tanks and they don't really do anything.
Yeah, I feel a little bad for Oda and Gamsu. The only time we've watched them in the series is they've been bashing heads, but not really in threat of killing one another. It's going to be a similar scenario. And I just want to keep an eye on how good Gamsu can use that explosive cast, because it can be very game-changing once the mobility spells have been used from H2K to just disengage the fights and find something opportunistic for Fnatic.
Gamsu's got to be careful there with his positioning. If he pushes too far up, reactive TP could come out, but Ryu needs to clear mid and the rest of H2K are on Rift Herald. But, you know, it's very interesting, especially Pulse, for you and I, when we look at Odo Amne. As a player, typically he's been one of the ones in legacy teams to look to break a tank meta all the way back in Season 3. You and I casted him when he was on Cloud9 Eclipse, and he was one of the very first people to look at the Trundle into Shyvana matchup before it exploded worldwide. He was one of the leading charges, and he hasn't been able to do that in this tank meta. At this setup for HK, it just hasn't quite been his open. Ooh, Vander tries to go in.
Nice flash by Spirit, and they'll clear out the wave there. But yeah, I totally agree, Stress. I mean, we've seen it in so many different metas that he's trying to innovate, but he's just like, oh, I'm just going to play tanks in this one.
Well, flash for flash, Vander didn't get a kill, but was able to at least apply pressure to Spirit. Big minion wave is lost down bottom as Reckless was able to just usher minions to that inner turret. And H2K, look at the vision they've set up around the top half of the map. We could be on for a Herald fight, gentlemen, some point.
I mean, the last Herald fight was very interesting. So this might come out and H2K got forced away from it.
It is still active on Yankos though, right now, so we're hey, a little way
I'm,
away from
I'm
that.
I'm getting excited about what could come. Don't kill my dreams.
I'm trying not to kill them. I'm trying.
Just means I've got to wait longer, that's all. But look at the middle lane, gentlemen, because H2K are going to use that Herald that was so rightly pointed out to me to push down the turret as best as possible. Yankos is going to back away. Continue to farm up and just pressure in multiple lanes. Fnatic are being forced to defend with this limited wave flare, and they're in some trouble.
And this is the thing, like, even though they don't get the turret on that push, what they do is they push top, drag multiple people up, and Fnatic can't really defend this early on without multiple people in the lane. Then they come mid, get damage down off the tower. It means they can pick it off very shortly. The next kind of push that comes mid is going to get that tower, so overall, H2K just chipping them down.
Just rinse and repeat, really, as soon as these objectives keep coming up. Big farm advantage in the mid lane, opening up for Ryu, 35 CS. Bottom lane for Givens is actually behind Reckless, but has been moving around the map a lot to make the objective happen instead.
I think important to note as well, Jankos just got a glimpse of them there. Five stacks from Mark of the Kindred. Already a real threat to anybody on the Fnatic squad. And H2K will be happy. They've got early game champions. They've got the ability to find picks. They've played it actually as you would have expected H2K to play it, up until we'd seen them in semifinals. Now they take the next step of getting past them in the turrets.
Yeah, getting past them is the key. I mean, for a minute there, I thought Reckless was excited at Clyde perhaps playing Taric in future because he was just sitting on a whole bunch of gems, just waiting, waiting, but he turns one into the Sheen. It was a good back timing for him and is able to look towards that Iceborne Gauntlet. But right now, we're in a situation where Fnatic, on the back foot, have to deal with what H2K are offering.
H2K are still continuing to pressure as well, and they've really started to open up the 1-3-1, and Fnatic have identified this and are looking for a fight, but so are H2K. Double teleport coming in, Klai is going to be backing off, and Odoane flashes in. He's going to knock Klai into his team with the Arcane Smash. Spirit is now under attack. Ryu goes in.
They're not done yet. H2K have found themselves two kills, have found themselves a tower, and they've even got minions still left to play with. They're looking for more.
They're going to continue to push into the Inhibitor Tower. It's 14 minutes into the game. But apparently H2K just don't realize.
No, they do not, and they don't care. Six towers down, plus 7,000 gold, and they've broken open Fnatic's base.
The entire time, Gamsu was down in the bottom lane, but H2K seize the opportunity and just go aggressive on Fnatic. Once again, they pick up Fly to start this off. Fly and Spirit responsible for 100% of the deaths so far in this game. And just look at this, Fnatic trying to go aggressive into the teleport. If you're trying to go aggressive here, Gamsu has to react. Gamsu cannot allow you to go in because against double TP, that is your bread and butter. You have to group with five, and H2K just go, okay, try us on the size, bring in the other two members, and suddenly they win the fight before Gamsu could ever have even thought about being there.
But why? Because Gamsu had TP.
Yeah.
Like, they went for that play, and it was like, well, we have 4-1, and they have a 1-3-1, so we're going to engage and have Gamsu surround them. Nope. I don't know why you wouldn't do that.
I don't have an answer for you, G-Pulse.
When it comes to backfire for Fnatic, no trigger pulled, and they're in trouble. Down 7k at 15 minutes, which is crazy. Forgiven's already picked up the package, got that Trinity Force completed, and a BF Sword. In comparison to the stacking Manamune and Sheen, significantly more powerful than Reckless at this stage.
But you've got to maybe look at the comparison now between this series and H2K series versus Origin, where H2K didn't have the best game one, Fnatic.
Well, RIP. So please do continue.
Didn't have the best game one for H2K, and then game two was rocky. Game three, they just show up, and it's just like, okay, we're just going to win this game, get back on form. Unfortunately for them, it wasn't the winner of the series for them, but man, H2K, they're showing us what they can do, given the right tools.
Yeah, and also maybe Fnatic just drawn into this series, where it's like, we just need to do the same thing over and over, and H2K have finally identified that, but great mental fortitude as well from them as well, not just tilting. Maybe they tilted and went 360 and then untilted.
The complete 360, yeah. Which in this case would actually put them back to where they started in the top case. Regardless, Gamsu, I think, giving some respect to Vanda, the moment Vanda showed in lane, Gamsu threw the ultimate down. Vanda has already played very aggressively this game, looking for those flash headbutt pulverized combos, and not going to be falling prey, Gamsu. Dragon number two picked up by H2K, completely uncontested.
And it's at this point that you have to look at it. How much did Fnatic really give away in this pick and ban phase? They first rotation in Ezreal, which basically says, well, please don't pick any early game. Which they got away with before because they were playing a different playstyle with the Azir, you know, being able to wave clear mid. And then they lock themselves with a last pick, Kassadin? I mean, come on, if anything's screaming like just go aggressive early at us, it's that. I mean, you lock in two scaling carries and man, H2K just go, okay, we'll play Lissandra, we'll play Maokai, we'll play Alistair, it's good.
I mean, they have the cushion right in this series because they need to win one more game, but you just want to end it. You don't want to try and play around, you don't want to just try and style on your opponent, you just want to finish off the series. And yeah, there was some curious decision made in pick and bans.
Yeah, it is very different. And I also have to give some props to Jankos. I called him out quite heavily for that Kindred first pick. It didn't work in games 1 and 2. It is so clearly working now in game 3. And this is a good demonstration of what Jankos can do when H2K have a good game plan that they all execute as a team.
But this is one of the reasons why picks like Kindred and Nidalee work so well right now in the Graves, is because you look at these lanes, Maokai, crowd control, Lissandra, crowd control. Great, you've got an Alistair in the bottom lane if you need to go there as well. So the facilitation comes from strong lane crowd control, and that allows Jankos to get the damage off. In previous games, perhaps he just wasn't really feeling it with the Ryze there. Yes, Ryze has crowd control, that is not what I'm trying to get away from.
But Ryze was losing as well.
Then certainly this is a lot more comfortable from H2K to be aggressive, rather than just trying to find aggressive openings.
A significant difference when you see the strength of those lanes, because Febiven was able to bully Ryu in those earlier games, plus the added ganks really made Ryu's life difficult. Rift Herald has been picked up, this vision being placed in the top quadrant of the jungle in H2K. Hey,
here
let's
we
go back
again.
In time, they're looking for a dive. Ryu does not follow the glacial path through to completion, and instead H2K just do the best they can. Klein playing on the front foot to defend the tower. Tower is being dropped very low. Banda forced to use Unbreakable Will, and Fnatic have engaged.
They will back away real quick, but they did manage to get the chip damage on the tower, and that's all H2K were really looking for.
But the timing is very awkward for H2K. Ryu had the goal to finish his Zhonya's Hourglass, so he's actually wanting to back right now. He's like, guys, let's not do any stupid fights, because I've just got my Zhonya's, there it is. He just crested 1050, so, I mean, he's like, oh, well, I've got this claw, and it's kind of going in, but I don't want to die, because then I'll look like a fool.
Yeah.
So, but this does now slow H2K. They will be fine, because they got the teleport available for Lissandra, but they can look to engage like that at another time.
Definitely pulled out. Jankos, he's going to be finding Kalai. But Febiven as well in this game, it's like a different kind of late game threat, because you have Kassadin, you stick him in the side lane, and generally he just like wins against anyone in that long lane. Last time it was Azir, and you go into team fights and he just murdered everyone. So Fnatic's late game is very different in this game.
Of course, for Jankos, 19 minutes in, 7 stacks on his passive. Sacred Devourer just completed as well. That is a terrifying carry that Fnatic have to try to deal with, and their front line is simply not tanky enough yet. Spirit has a Hex Drinker and Swifties. Like, he's gonna melt.
Because, I mean, realistically, you look at this team fight, Ryu goes in, he ults himself, he's Zhonya's, Jankos ults on him, you've got a Maokai for damage reduction. There is no real clear threat outside of Forgiven, who's gonna be on Corki and sat further back in this team fight presence. There's no real threat to pick off. If you're Fnatic, it's so difficult to kill anybody from H2K in the initial fight that they just kind of kill someone and win.
We'll find out if Fnatic can find that opportunity. They're still down 7,000 gold at 20 minutes. On the third attempt at taking that inner top tower, H2K secure it, meaning there are no more towers to fall outside of Fnatic's base. And H2K have done a very good job of keeping the deep vision, of keeping Fnatic defending. And you can see in the CS totals falling behind in almost every regard except for Spirits.
And Fnatic now are just in a really tough situation. 7 towers over to H2K now, and they're constantly just in the jungle, warding up, going from lane to lane, and just trying to probably just take down this last inhib. Well, the first inhib that is now exposed in the mid lane.
Right now, though, it is the danger zone for H2K when you look at it, because this is where they've struggled at this point. And, I mean, at this point, really, H2K have got to look for the aggressive options, where they can look for objectives. They don't have the Kalista. They don't have the ability to just take the Baron down, and even last game didn't work so well for them.
Luckily, they do still have 2 TPs and 2 very important point-and-click CCs.
Yeah.
Let's see if they can coordinate to use them at the right time. Infinity Edge was picked up by Forgiven not too long ago to go with that Trinity Force as well, so a lot of damage coming out of that Corki and Odo shoving bottom. So H2K, save control, secure, and they'll be looking for opportunities to punish Fnatic.
They've been very close to death there. It's just, it's so difficult to play the situation as Fnatic, because you really want to defend this in here, but H2K, they have so many ways to just instantly pick someone up with, like, Lissandra, with Maokai. If you step an inch too forward, you're probably just losing this game.
Yeah, 1 inch from Fnatic. If they step over the line, Ryu or Odo, they'll look for the target. Look at those claws of doom being thrown out by Ryu. He wants it to find a pick. Gamsu's waiting in the wings. The tension is slowly building as H2K are trying to set up, but they're taking some poke from Reckless.
And Fnatic are forced to just group mid. They can't play. Ooh,
oh,
Spirit!
There's the engage, and Spirit is locked into a frozen tomb. He's going down. Inhibitor will be picked up from H2K, and they have broken the base of Fnatic.
Yeah, I have no idea how Spirit got deaded there, but H2K just made it look so easy. Super minions in the middle lane. They can even back away, get some control of this jungle, and maybe look to play around Baron.
It looked about as clinical from the minimap as a ward being there, and Spirit just steps towards it, maybe even tries to clear it. I didn't see exactly what happened, and then H2K just come over the wall, blow him up because he had no way of escaping. That's going to mean the Baron attempt here from H2K is on, and with Spirit 5 seconds away, this would have to be a massive mistake.
Dropping very low, true shot barrage.
Good timing.
Close.
But Jankos is there, so he has Smite. That would not be a smite you want to mess up in this series, but Baron goes over to H2K, got those two dragons as well.
And the audience is stunned here in Rotterdam as H2K extend their lead to 10,000 gold. 100% kill participation for Jankos. 23 minutes into the game. I mean, it is as one-sided as a game can be at this level of play.
I must admit, I was wondering what the reaction would be like if Fnatic were to fall behind in a game. It's one of the great things about having a large crowd. You kind of, each crowd has its own personality. You know, in rugby, Croke Park goes quiet, silent, to give the respect to a kicker. And here, clearly behind Fnatic, but unfortunately, Fnatic not ahead in this game. We'll see if they can find an opening. It's going to be tough here with H2K with this Baron.
Very, very tough. I mean, looking at the ways they can bounce back into this game, like Kasten really can't go on the side lane now. They're now looking into team fights, getting drawn into that because H2K will force them, and they have a team fighting composition. So Fnatic, again, if they get caught out like Spirit was, they'll just lose more and more of the base as Oduwane goes in.
He's tower diving, the tower's down. Already an objective secured by H2K. Teleport for Gamsu defensively, but he's running around saying, what do? Who do I look for? The answer is Jankos. He's got the first kill of the fight for Fnatic with Spirit's locked down. H2K looking to find another. They won't be able to shut him down, but they'll be content with the fight and the base from Fnatic.
They'll back off, they take down the inhibitor, rest of the minions are flooding in. Had they not lost Jankos there, maybe they could have pushed for more. But that was a one for one, but ultimately, more inhibitors going down.
And Febi just could not find the angle to get into that fight to deal damage. There's too much going on with Ryu's crowd control. Oduwane in there. Yes, Jankos got picked up because it was Gamsu coming in from the side, blasting him away. So let's take another look. Twisted Advance came out from Odo onto Clyde. Reckless manages to get himself back and out of the fight, but this TP from Gamsu, and he TP's in, doesn't instantly have the option here. You can see, there we go, off to the side goes Jankos, picked off, but it's still a win for H2K. They get a second inhibitor down, and at this point, it's going to be so difficult for Fnatic to come back into this because it would take a monumental error from H2K in this kind of situation. H2K just want to fight. They are so far ahead.
This is a lose-lose situation for Fnatic, though. They step forward, someone gets caught. If they go for a team fight, they still lose because H2K are one so far ahead and have team fight. In this game, they just, as you said, Stress, they have to wait for H2K to mess up.
They fell too far behind too early on, and H2K, they're looking for one more dive. This will not be a mistake for H2K. They've broken another tower down. The inhibitor will fall shortly thereafter, and Ryu's taking a lot of damage from Fnatic, but it simply will not matter. It's a 5v4. Supers are inside the base of Fnatic, and H2K with the Baron buff. I'm going to be looking to finish this one off, but just wears off in the last few seconds. And a teleport coming to re-engage.
Nah, they're going for round two. They have the minions coming in. They're just trying to set up the waves. And
Zoom.
Ryu, he's looking for someone. But that's the great thing about sending Lissandra back, is with Home Gods, you can very easily find a target who doesn't expect you to go in there.
Yeah, Ryu just wants to be in the picture as this game ends at this point. He's like, I've got this, guys. H2K just waiting for the situation to go in.
And there may have found it. Gamsu's taking a lot of damage, and he'll be killed before he can even use the ultimate. The Nexus turret will be the target for most of H2K. Lamb's Respite gets thrown down from Jankos to buy time, and Forgiven's buying all the time that H2K need. This is the first game in the series that H2K look to be picking up. The fight's not over yet!
But they're dropping so low! Three people go down, shut down over the Forbidden, double kill for Reckless, Oduwane, the only one left alive, and that is 5-4-1, triple kill to Forbidden!
Fnatic will not go down without a fight, and despite being behind, they hold on for at least one more fight.
The slight overstep by H2K trying to end the game too quickly, and Fnatic have punished them for now, but Fnatic are locked inside their base right now.
All three inhibitors are down. There are double supers coming through, and this was the fight that bought some breathing room for Fnatic.
You can see, look, H2K just trying to push up to take that second turret down. Ryu did not have his survival tools available, and this is the dangerous point for a Kassadin, for an Ezreal in these fights where they're able to get up kills. All of the kills from this fight went over to the carries of Fnatic, but you are entirely correct with the inhibitors being down. Mid lane has respawned, and there is no Baron available yet for H2K. It had only just dropped off them for that fight. So it means H2K's real only place to go is that middle inhibitor. They will have to think twice about fighting Fnatic again, though, but still H2K have a good lead in this game.
Fnatic holding on by a thread in this game. But yeah, there's only one place to go. That's the mid lane.
And it is the
teleport from Odawande. That means that Fnatic can't go up as one or two people because they'll get caught. So inhibitor goes down. H2K just need to play this safe because they still have all these super minions flooding into the base. So realistically, Fnatic can't fight them. And there's those two Nexus turrets alive.
Oh, we'll find out if H2K
dead.
Look for a target. It's an engage from Gumsu. He's managed to throw Yankos to the front line. Featherman waiting in the wings. But H2K have too strong a front line. And there's the package. Forgiven sends Fnatic reeling. It's H2K with three kills. Forgiven even survives. And Reckless is forced to run away. The Nexus will be going down. And H2K will not go down without a fight.
That's the H2K that people talk about when they say this team could potentially have made it all the way to the finals. The problem is they have had mistakes in other games and they are still only one win on the board in this series. I mean, Fnatic have looked better in the first two games, apart from maybe the beginning of H2K's game one.
Shell shock look on Fairbairn's face there after what was a very, very heavy-handed defeat. The Pixar band screamed, we need time. And H2K said, nope, we're not giving it to you.
Fnatic taken out of comfort zone, honestly, in that game because they were pressured early. And I wasn't expecting H2K to be that good in the early game to actually get the ball rolling and be able to pressure on Fnatic. They turned up in this game and that definitely caught them off guard.
And the question is, can H2K do it again? Because this is what H2K tried to do multiple times against Origin and they failed. They didn't pull the trigger earlier in the series, and now everything just seems to fall into place.
But I think the interesting thing is game one, the beginning of game one seems so far away. That H2K that came out swinging, crushed the 2v2,
yeah,
and managed to keep themselves in that game, ultimately to lose it, seems so far away. This was a little bit more of what we expect from H2K, like the start of game one, but I'm glad they at least showed us something. They showed us a good, strong game in that one, and I'm glad to see it because it means that we've at least go into game four.
Yep.
Yeah, but we know they can team fight now. Like,
yeah,
if you give them, okay, they had four champions who were just like very difficult not to team fight with, but we know they can do it. And we just need to see more from them.
Then one caveat, we know they can team fight with a 4,000 gold. I think that
does. And a lead in the early game, and a team fighting composition, but yeah.
But also, the two guys who were so heavily criticized in the semifinals, Yankos and Vanda, they did not show up last weekend. This game, they both showed up in epic fashion.
Well, now that the series has been blown wide open, we're going to send it over to the analyst desk to see how H2K fired back.
Thank you very much, and indeed H2K very much back in this, or not out I should say, rather 2-1 now. And I am thinking back to last week when we have five games of H2K versus OG, and game three was H2K being massively ahead, playing their own game, making the right choices, but it was only game three. So where do you guys see the differences here?
You know what happened last time we played game three and did the same? Kassadin was picked in the mid lane one more time. Ryu said, oh, is that a free laning phase for me? Thank you very much. I'm going to push that one down, not die to a random first blood, of course. And suddenly we can actually play our game 1-3-1 perfect and take all the outer turrets.
And also, you wanted some praise for your prediction of the Picks and Bans in game three?
I mean, that's on you guys, right? Tell me, guys, what happened in the Pick and Ban phase? And what did I say would happen?
Well, no, because during the break he said, listen, I predicted it all. Ask me about it. And now you give it.
I actually wanted to bring it up. The Fisher had a good predictor on pick and bans. And I think it was a good pivot from HGK overall.
Thank you.
with absolute disrespect from Fnatic. Yeah. I mean, if a team is letting you play your style on stage like that, getting away with murder when it comes to very passive late-game compositions, don't insult them by picking Kassadin. That is just a mark too much. And HTK is like, what? I challenge this position. They push in every, like, all these lanes. They start rotating, and suddenly Fnatic just falls super far behind.
I think Fnatic has disrespected HTK a bit. They're like, oh, they're doing nothing early game with their double TPs. They're doing nothing. We can just scale up for free. And they just went for a scaling comp, and we see what happens when HTK plays their game.
Shook, as a pro player, how do teams keep doing this? Because we see this so often. Up to, oh, I know you get in your comfort zone, but why doesn't someone just tell you, hey, don't play risky?
I don't know, it's just a matter of best of five. Like, I assume they thought HTK would not do anything in the early game again, so they're just waiting to see how it goes in skill. But they go for a scaling comp and they get punished finally, and that's what I like to see.
In terms of how this series, you know, affects certain players, Forgiven, while he had a little bit of a rough spot earlier, yes, the low damage wasn't only due to him. Obviously, it's the way his team set him up. This game, he had the most damage on his team. At least, yes, he's playing a poke champion, so that kind of makes it a lot easier. But at least he had a higher impact. We saw Zhou in some of those fights not afraid to go in for the damage, and I think this will be really good for HTK's like mental strength in the series, because they show that like when they played their style, they can still absolutely dominate an early game.
And I think even more important, they showed in the pick and ban phase that when you take away the Azir, there was right now not a good answer for Forbidden to get mid lane control back. I just think for Fnatic here, going Ezreal Kassadin was the wrong move. I think they wanted to take early Ezreal, maybe thinking Forgiven would steal it away now that Kalista hadn't worked for him. And that's why they early picked it and then realized all the way down with the last pick. They're like, okay, what's our normal counter pick to Lissandra? It's the Kassadin. For a lot of teams, other teams would do like a zillion. But in this case, they're like, oh, all right, go for that counter pick, see if we can outplay it. But now suddenly we actually have a bad composition if we put it all together. So I think they just looked too much at the individual rotations. Ezreal in that first rotation shook. We didn't like it.
I'm not a fan of Ezreal at first rotation. I think it gives you a free lane. If you can just pick whatever AD carry and have a free lane, then I think Ezreal should be a later on pick.
And also a difference from the HUK in games 1 and 2 to 3 in our last replay, they built up a lead early game, actually 6K lead at 20 minutes, and they just seemed more aggressive in all of their moves when we said they were too much holding back in game 1. This is where they went all in.
And that just generates such force engages by Fnatic too, that where then HUK can use a double teleport to come in, because they have enough time. A lot of these picks, whether it's the Azir being off the table in terms of push or the gold lead, it buys HTK time to really punish some of these bold moves by Fnatic, and that's exactly what happened there.
Again, Azir gives you mid lane control, which stops the push from happening, but also that fight, Gamzu was still sitting bot lane.
Yeah, that wasn't a good fight.
But what's going on here, guys? And also, Engage was exhausting an Alistar. I don't think Alistar will ever deal enough damage to really force an exhaust unless...
I know, man, the ulti.
Alistar thing coming. Yeah. I'm not too sure.
Well, we'll have to ask them if we get a chance. However, how much then going into the next game is now connected to the specific picks that HTK got their hands up, because Fnatic, we will assume, won't be as overzealous next game and maybe not go for that full late game comp. I feel like a lot is obviously connected to that Lissandra mid lane for Ryu, because if anything else fails, you know that he'll be able to do something on that. Anything else that Fnatic has to shut down?
I mean, Fnatic can just steal the Lissandra early as well. HTK can only get their hands on so many picks in that first pick, obviously, and then they can have a good reaction. That's why Purple Sight is sometimes really fun to play, and that means you can leave your counter pick maybe for Reckless on that AD carry if you're putting a tank top anyways.
I also think it's a weak rotation when you take early Ezreal and then you give the Maokai one more time and you pick a Gragas into it. Mm-hmm. Why not just go Braum Maokai then as your first rotation in this example? Get either Sivir or Ezreal once you've seen the enemy AD carry, hopefully. And then, of course, steal away Lissandra. It's a fantastic pick for Febiven.
Yeah, I agree. Fnatic should aim to get the Lissandra going if Azir is banned, so he can finally get some mid pressure going and some TP plays themselves.
Now we'll see HUK coming on strong in game 3, but Fnatic is still just one win away from securing third place in the European Spring Split. We'll see if H2K can bring us all the way to game 5 when we return.
Every solo kill is gonna be the crowd going mental. You know?
Whoa! Whoa! Yeah. Imagine I got Banta kill.
Oh! Flash over the wall. Banta gets the hit, but pulverizer onto Clyde. First blood secured by H2K.
We can kill Brown. We can go. Someone else. Flash on someone. Speed it. No flash. Yes. We can kill him. I still have ult.
Take down.
Maybe we can take Inkip to that.
Maybe.
No.
Fnatic are forced to just group mid. They can't play. Oh, spirit.
There's the engage.
And H2K will not go down without a fight.